Good morning. And welcome to worship here at First United Presbyterian Church of Dale City in Virginia. My name is Pastor Adam. We are so very glad that you have joined us either in person or online. We now ask that you find the fellowship pad located on the chair closest to the center aisle and take that and fill out the information it requests. If you have a prayer concern, know that it would be our honor and privilege to pray for you and yours. And you can fill that prayer card out. Choose who receives the information and drop it in the box in our welcome center. If you are visiting or it's your first or second time, we have the other side of that prayer card is a connect card. We would love to connect with you, and you can bring that to our welcome table in the welcome center again. We have a gift for you and can also answer any questions you may have about this worshiping community. If you are worshiping online, you can do all of this electronically on our website, www.fupcdc.org. Click that online attendance and prayer request button. We also have our bulletin online, and obviously you have those hopefully in person in your hands. I draw your attention to page 7 for some important announcements. I'm not going to mention all of them because we have a lot going on today, but I wanted to remind you that you should have received, if you're a member or friend of the church, a stewardship letter and card, and Dennis Dingle is going to say more about that in a few moments, but next Sunday is Pledge Dedication Sunday, so bring those pledges back. We will present them to the Lord. It's also Fall Back Sunday, so you get an extra hour of sleep. It's our gift to you. No, we hope you enjoy that. It's my favorite one. I do not like changing, really. Also, next Sunday, we will celebrate All Saints Day and All Saints Sunday. So if you have a loved one who passed away in the last year, who went to be with the Lord and would like to honor them in worship, you can send that information to the church office by tomorrow, if possible. Tomorrow's the deadline for that. Our men are having breakfast this coming Saturday. Information about that is in the bulletin as well. Wednesday Night Alive, we're back to having meals, and the first one is a potluck. Everybody loves a potluck, so bring a dish to share this Wednesday. At 6 o'clock, we will have our potluck dinner. At 7 o'clock, there's chancel choir rehearsal. I'm sure they'll love you to join them if you would like. And also, I will be leading a Bible study in room 22 and online. And then I think praise team rehearses after that at 8. So Wednesday Night Lives are back to kind of what we say was, quote, normal, and we are looking forward to that. We are also looking for folks to help out with the meals. Our longtime folks who organize that, the guests have kind of retired after, I think, over 10 years of doing that. So if you would like to help out, please see Betsy Gilbert, and a special thank you to the guests for the many years that they organized that. Youth group, there's no youth group tonight. We're going to meet tomorrow night on All Hallows Eve at my house for dinner and then to go trick-or-treating with my family. If it rains and there's a 50% chance of rain, it will turn into a movie party probably in my basement. So we're rain or shine. Please text me or email me if you are planning on coming or your youth is planning on coming. And I also wanted to say thank you, thank you, thank you. I see many of you out there who helped out with our fall festival yesterday. It was a huge success. Yes, thank you, thank you. We had, by my count, over 250 kids come through the prize room alone. We had to send some people to the store to get more prizes. It's a good problem to have, a big, amazing outreach event. We also had folks going around and asking our neighbors, oh, what can we pray for you? What are your prayer concerns and needs? And those are out here on this bulletin board. So we encourage you to go look at those and pray for the folks who came to our fall festival and lift their needs up in prayer. Those are all the announcements I have. We have session notes, which I know forgot to put that in the bulletin. Kathy Albrecht is going to give those to us. Kathy.
Welcome our 6 new adult members and 6 kids whom we received during the service last Sunday. Yay! A budget task force has been formed and is working on church 2023 budget. A commission has been formed to review our church membership roles. The session minutes and clerk books were approved without exception by National Capital Presbytery. A special thanks to our Sarah Porter and office manager Kim Parker. She works very hard. The session visioning retreat took place on October 15th at the Lutheran Church of the Covenant. We are finishing up the visioning for the future direction of this church. The county has approved our electric sign. Yay, double yay. Coordination between the electrical contractors and our sign company, Sign Enterprise, is now in progress. A special collection of food will be taken for students in need at our partner school. The Dale City Elementary School was approved the recipient of the food for the month of November. Thank you.
It's amazing. We got bureaucracy moving and got our electronic sign approved. We're excited. Thank you. A special thanks to Rick Mitchell and Bruce Gilbert for working on that and the task force, because, oh my gosh, you can take years. So we did it quicker than almost any other place I know of. So I now invite our Chair of Stewardship and Finance, Dennis Dingle, to give us our moment for stewardship. Dennis.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Dennis Dingle from your Stewardship and Finance Ministry team. In conjunction with the celebration of our FUPFI DC 50th anniversary, this year's stewardship theme is reflecting on our past, committing to our future. During the anniversary celebration, we heard from members of the congregation who described their memories here at FUPFI DC and their hopes for the future of the church. Over the past several weeks, we've heard from members of our church, past and present, who shared their experiences at FUPFI DC and described how stewardship messages have changed from the early days through the mid-2000s, and how FUPFI DC has impacted their lives and the lives of the congregation over the years. Recent stewardship messages have focused on the generous giving of time and talent by this congregation, and how God has shown us that all we do, no matter how big or how small, is a part of the woven fabric that is FUPC DC. My family first came to this church in the early 1990s when we were looking for a place to worship. What we found was a church that offered youth programs for our children and a wide variety of opportunities for worship, growth, and service. But more importantly, and why we stayed, we found a caring, compassionate, and welcoming church congregation that was not only focused on the people who attended FUPFI DC, but also on the communities around us in Northern Virginia, the country, and the world. We're blessed at FUPFI DC to have an active, passionate, talented, generous, and engaged congregation. To continue those ministries that make this church what it is today and continue our growth in the future, our budget relies heavily on the commitments received as a part of the stewardship campaign. We recognize that the current economic environment has affected us all individually and may have an impact on the church's ability to support God's work through FUPFI DC. Understanding that while you may be facing unique challenges, we're asking that you prayerfully consider making a pledge for 2023. By pledging, the session is able to develop a workable budget to support the church and those ministries that are important and impactful on us all and on the communities around us. Your commitment, no matter the amount, is a covenant between you and God. Our goal is for every family and individual, members, friends, and non-members to pledge. We invite you to bring your 2023 stewardship commitment forward on November 6, 2022, Dedication Sunday, to confirm your commitment. In addition to the stewardship letter and pledge form that were mailed on October 22nd, an electronic pledge form is available on the church website. If you did not receive a mailing or otherwise need a pledge form, they'll be available in the narthex after next week's service, or you can contact a member of the stewardship team. I'll end with the scripture for this year's stewardship campaign from 1 Corinthians 12, verses 4 through 6. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone is the same God at work. Thank you.
Thank you.
Reformation Sunday. As you are able, I invite you to stand and join me in our call to worship. Are you awake? Are you alert? Christ is coming into our lives in a new way. Are you watching the signs? Are you interpreting what is happening today? Christ is coming into our lives in a new way. Do you see opportunities for ministry? Do you see the poor, the homeless, the hungry, the needy? Christ is coming into our lives in a new way. Come, let us worship and let us do the work God has for us. Christ has extended the invitation. Let us work together for God's kingdom on earth. Let's sing.
God of justice and peace, bring your dazzling light into our hearts and spirits that we might see the glorious opportunities we have to serve you. Help us to see that following your mandate to feed the hungry, bring refreshment to those who thirst, offer clothing to those in need, visit the sick and those who are imprisoned, welcome the stranger, any activity of service as an act of great privilege and joy. We praise you for the light of your Son, Jesus Christ, who boldly bids us care for each other and become those who would bring good news of peace for all. Amen. Amen. How quickly we forget our faith, our calling, our hope, all because we tried to do everything our way rather than God's. But God is quick to forgive and to restore us to new life. Let us confess to our God as we pray together, saying, Merciful God, we get so caught up in our own lives and needs that we fail to see others for whom we might provide some help and relief. You challenge us to feed those who are hungry and to quench the thirst of those who are parched. You ask us to bring clothing to those who have none or for whom their clothing is inadequate, to visit people who are sick, alone, alienated, who are imprisoned either in cells with bars or in conditions of hopelessness and poverty, to welcome the stranger and reach out to those who are marginalized, to always bring your words of healing and redeeming love. We have failed in these tasks. We ignore the opportunities and claim that we are too busy to help, too busy to care. Forgive us, O God. Forgive us and heal our wounds of greed and selfishness. Let us be reminded that we can be a part of Christ's glorious kingdom of peace and compassion. Hear us now as we continue to confess in the silence of our hearts.
Amen. Friends, we gather here at the font because I know I've messed up this week. I'm sure all of us have. But we have a God whose love is poured out for each and every one of us, whose forgiveness overflows in our lives and in our hearts. So hear these words of assurance. This is our assurance. God forgives us. This is our hope. God's love is everlasting. This is our truth. God is with us always. We speak the truth. We will live the hope. We will share God's mercy. Hearing this, know that we are indeed forgiven and be at peace. Thanks be to God. Please stand as we sing our response. Children and young at heart, come and gather on the chancel steps for the time for children. I invite you to pass the peace in whichever way you feel most comfortable. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you all and also with you. Peace, peace be with you.
Good morning. It's the last Sunday of the month, so it's time for our 252 Kids recap. We just wanted to keep everyone up to date on what we're learning about down the hall and around the corner. So For the month of October, our theme was Cliffhanger, The Story Isn't Over Yet. We are going through the Bible chronologically this year and focusing on God's big story. So we are still in the Old Testament, but we have moved into Exodus this month. And our focus for the month has been on grit and what that means. And we had defined that as refusing to give up when life gets hard. So the first Sunday in October, we started learning the story of Joseph. We couldn't fit it all into one Sunday, which I know is not a surprise. And our bottom line for the month was that you need to hold on because God is with you. And then the second Sunday in October, we continued Joseph's story when Joseph was in prison, and then he had the opportunity to interpret Pharaoh's dream that no one else could interpret, and things really turned around for him. So we learned that you can hold on because there's a bigger story. And then for the rest of October, we have focused on the story of Moses. So we started with Moses' mom having grit, refusing to give up, and placing her baby in the river in the hands of God, and learned that you can hold on even when you don't know what to do. Last week, we continued that story by hearing about God's plan to rescue the Israelites, and learn that you can hold on because God knows what you're going through. And after this service, before the 11th service, we are going to finish up that story with the parting of the Red Sea and the Exodus, and we're going to learn that you can hold on because God is in control. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, okay, those were some really beefy, heavy stories, so what's up next? Well, our... We also learned a memory verse, which is on the screen, so let's all say it together. The words are there.
Ready? Let us not become tired of doing good. At the right time, we will gather a crop if we don't give up.
And that's from Galatians
6:9. Okay, I didn't see it.
So anyone up for the challenge? I feel like Sarah can probably do it. I'm not going to ask you to do it by yourself. I'm just saying, I feel like we've somebody in here probably. But if you catch up with Kennedy, Clara, Oscar, any of our regular attenders, they will be able to do this for you because they actually did it last week and the week before. So I took the words out. Let's try one more time. Let us not become tired of doing good. At the right time, we will gather a crop if we don't give up. Okay. I got ahead of myself. In November, our theme is going to be Stand, Don't Face Your Fears Alone. So if you have a chance, please come down, check out what we're doing. We will be talking about courage all month long and what that means. And we would love for people to invite their friends, neighbors, your neighbor's kids, your neighbor's grandkids. We really do have a lot of fun down there. And I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Adam for our prayer.
All right. Well, I also add, because many of you guys know that I'm a musical fan, that when I think of last month's theme, you know, there's a musical, Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat, and a movie musical called The Prince of Egypt. So if you want to review what you learned, you know, go watch those. But anyway, let us go to the Lord in prayer and pray for continued learning. And I hope you guys can stay after this and join us for 252 Kids, all right? Let us pray. I'll say a line, you guys.
Dear God, thank you for all you do for us. For reminding us to hold on, have some grit.
Because you are always with us. And you're powerful, and you love us. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. All right, let me know what grade you're in, and I have your little devotional booklets. What grade are you in? Fourth grade, so that is one of these. And what grade are you in, Denzel, remind me? Fourth as well. So if you fill those out and bring them, I think you can earn special prizes and things in 252 Kids, all right? It was good seeing you guys this morning. Thanks for coming. All right, hope you guys have a great week.
Gentle and strong God, to serve you is freedom and to know you is joy. Quiet in us the voices competing for our allegiance, and remove from us any thought that does not come from you. By your Spirit, reveal the life-giving reign of Jesus Christ to us and all the world. Amen. Our gospel lesson today is from Matthew 25, verses 31 through 40. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it when we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it to me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Amen. Truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it to me. Jesus said it. Profound, radical words. The thing that strikes me about this familiar teaching is the element of surprise. And to rightly understand the point of this entire section, we need to make sure we first understand the context. If we were to rewind the tape to the end of chapter 24 of Matthew, we discover that Jesus has been talking with his disciples about his return at the end of this age. As he states in chapter 24, verse 44, "So you also must be ready." To stress that, Jesus, beginning in verse 45 of the previous chapter, provides three parables regarding readiness for his return. The first parable is about servants entrusted with a certain household responsibilities while their master of the house is away. The second parable is about 10 bridesmaids, some of whom were and some of whom were not ready to meet the groom and the rest of the wedding party when they came at night. And finally, like the first parable, the third parable describes a master going away on business. But before he leaves, he entrusts some of his money to his servants so that he can make a profit with it while he's away. So if Jesus is preparing his disciples and us for his coming, clearly verse 31 in today's lesson describes what will happen when he comes. Why must we be ready for the return of Christ? Because when Jesus comes, he will judge. Jesus has repeated the warning that the final judgment will come when we least expect it. When the Son of Man comes in glory, it will be a big surprise to everyone. And this theme of surprise shows up again and again in Matthew. Back in chapter 22 of Matthew, we heard of a wedding guest who was surprised to be thrown out of the party because he wasn't dressed correctly. The foolish bridesmaids at the beginning of chapter 25 were surprised when they run out of oil, and they are further surprised to be shut out of the wedding feast when they arrived after the door had been closed. The third servant of that final parable was surprised that his master had expected him to invest the talent he had been given instead of burying it for safekeeping, as conventional wisdom would have indicated. And now we see that both the sheep and the goats are surprised to learn that they have encountered the good shepherd whenever they meet the least of these. Whether they were caring for the needs of others or ignoring those needs, the surprise is the same. "Lord, when did we see you?" they both ask. And I think the reason both sheep and goats show surprise is also the same. When responding out of our primary identity, it doesn't occur to us that we're doing anything special or unusual. It isn't that caring for the poor, the sick, and the hungry makes you into a sheep instead of a goat. Caring for the poor, the sick, and the hungry simply shows the world whether you already are a sheep or a goat. The way you respond to the least of these demonstrates where your true identity lies. Because if your identity lies in yourself or what you think makes you important in this world, you won't see the needs around you as something that should matter to you. But when you identify with Jesus, you see Jesus in others, whether they are sick or poor or hungry or in prison. You see them as Jesus sees them, and you see Jesus in them. When meeting the Lord in the least instead of the greatest, the righteous will respond out of righteousness, and those who are not righteous will not. And that's where the rub comes in this parable, because too often we don't see others as Christ. We don't recognize Christ in the people we encounter every day. We don't respond to each person in the same way we'd think we'd respond to Jesus if we met him on the street. But what would happen if we recognized Christ in each of the people we encounter every day and respond to each person knowing that he or she was Jesus? How differently would we behave to the person who rings up our groceries or hands us our lunch through the drive-up window? How would we react to that obnoxious coworker or the people who act like they are better than we are? How could we be changed if we knew that each unsuspecting, unexpected meeting was really a chance to look into the eyes of Christ himself? You see, just as he came to earth in human form, Jesus will come again to rule as Christ the King, which we're going to celebrate in a few weeks. But in the meantime, Christ comes among us as one of the least of these, asking for food, in need of shelter, calling our attention to the thirst for living water that we see all around us, if we will only look. And Jesus comes in a way that makes him accessible to us in our need as well. Caroline Lewis writes, at the end of the day, to claim Christ as King, to believe in God's reign, has to be a claim on our present, and not just the future glory of thy kingdom come. How we decide to live matters, not just for ourselves, not just for those immediately around us, but for the sake of the reign of Christ here and now. So what is the point of the parable of the sheep and the goats for us in the here and now? Do we really need another story of division and separation in this time of growing polarization in our society? In a season when we long to hear a word of encouragement and hope, do we really need to be reminded about judgment? Yes, we do. In fact, I think Jesus tells these stories about judgment at the end of time in order to offer us some encouragement and hope. And now I know that sounds crazy, but people who don't believe is that like I believe are going to get what's coming to them when Jesus separates the sheep and the goats. No, friends. You see, the Hebrew word often translated as righteousness in our Bible is rich in meaning. It means justice or God-rightness. But what we too often forget is that God's justice includes both judgment and mercy. And that's a good thing for all of us. Just as both groups of bridesmaids, both of them, fell asleep while waiting for the bridegroom, both the sheep and the goats failed to recognize Jesus and the people they had encountered, the sick and the hungry, and naked and imprisoned. Neither of who cared or those who ignored the least of these saw Jesus when they met him. And that's the point. Whether you recognize him or not, whether your lamp is lit or not, Jesus still comes. Jesus shows up for us in the mundane, everyday interactions we have with others, if only in the way we think about them. Even there, Jesus comes to us. Remember that Jesus tells all of these parables about the time when God's reign will be fully established within the context of Holy Week. Within 48 hours, Jesus will wash his disciples' feet and tell them, I have set an example that you should do as I have done for you. But just before that happens, a couple of Greeks approach Philip and say, Sir, we would see Jesus. John's gospel, of course, never tells us if they get to have that face-to-face interview. But isn't it interesting that they have to ask in the way that they do? We would see Jesus, or we want to see Jesus. I have a feeling that if Jesus had been in earshot, he might have responded, You would you? Well, just look around. Tony Campolo, a well-known preacher and professor of religion, tells a story of a surprising encounter he had one day as he traveled into work. He was passing down the sidewalk in Philadelphia, dressed up as usual in his nice suit and overcoat, when he was stopped short by a homeless man, filthy from head to toe, with food still clinging to his long beard. The man was holding a cup of McDonald's coffee, and when he saw Dr. Campolo, he called out to him, offering him some of his coffee. In an effort to be courteous, Campolo took the cup and drank a little, already doing something at which most of us would probably cringe. And he asked the man why he had been so generous with his coffee. What had gotten into him all of a sudden to offer his coffee to someone else. The homeless man replied, "Well, the coffee was especially delicious this morning, and I figured if God gives you something good, you ought to share it with people." Campolo figured that there was more coming, that the man would want something in return, so he just went ahead and asked him if there was something he could give him in return. Much to his surprise, rather than asking for money, the man said, "Yeah, you can give me a hug." So there on the sidewalk in downtown Philadelphia, Campolo reached out and hugged this filthy man, and the man hugged him back. And they held on for an extended amount of time. And over time, people began to stare, caught off guard by the slight sight of a nicely dressed businessman and a homeless man embracing. Now, at first, Campolo was embarrassed, but then his embarrassment gave way to wonder. Campolo later said, "I heard a voice echoing down the corridors of time saying, 'I was hungry. Did you feed me? I was the bum you met on Chestnut Street. Did you hug me? For if you did it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. And if you failed to do it unto the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you failed to do it unto me.'" It's risky, welcoming and caring for the stranger. Hugging the stranger may be the scariest of all, but it's riskier not to do so, not to live as Jesus taught us. Without it, the church loses its outward focus and becomes absorbed inwardly, only serving those within the walls and spending all its time and resources on its own survival. This slowly weakens the church, stunting its spiritual vitality. And the same thing happens, by the way, to us as individuals as well. But to be a disciple of Christ, to be a church moving towards fulfilling God's will, we must make it our mission, and service. Mission and service must be our priority. Friends, we must be a Matthew 25 church. We must remember and look back and remember that this church was founded as a church of service for the people who were all made in God's image. Service and mission have always been a part of the ethos, the makeup of FUPSI DC. Even Spread the Bread, our homeless feeding ministry, started in March of 2009, which doesn't seem like that long ago until you sit down and do the math and realize that we started Spread the Bread 13 years and 7 months ago. Since that day, we have been feeding the hungry and homeless after our worship services, rain or snow or sunshine each week. I did some more math. That means that so far we have provided 706 Sundays of meals to about 50 people each time in that parking lot by our bus depot here in Prince William. This is around 35,300 hungry people fed by one small church in Dale City. Why? Because of Jesus Christ. Because that is what the church is supposed to be about. Friends, the parable of the sheep and goats teaches us to stop looking for Jesus, stop wishing you could see him face to face, and start realizing that you see Jesus in every single person you encounter. Start seeing Jesus in the ones who need the food that we put in the Acts food pantry box, and the ones who are fed in that bus parking lot, the ones who agree with your political opinions, and the ones who clearly do not. The ones who are victims of crime and the ones who commit those crimes. And the oppressed and the oppressors. The ones who've hurt you and the ones you've hurt. Start seeing Jesus because he's there, waiting for you to recognize him, to receive him, to accept his forgiveness, and to enter into his joy. And when that happens, when you start seeing Jesus in the least, as well as the greatest, they won't be least or great anymore. They will become part of us, one in Christ. And you may be surprised that when you see Jesus in them, they will be able to see Jesus in you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, the invitation is this. As you contemplate your pledge to church this week, think about what the homeless man said about his coffee. I figured if God gives you something good, you ought to share it with other people. Everything is a gift from God, and everyone is made in God's image. So go and see Christ in others. Feed the hungry. Give the thirsty some water. Clothe the naked. Visit the prisoner. Care for the sick. And be ready for a surprise when Christ shows up, when you least expect it. Also know that the invitation to follow Jesus Christ is always an open one, as is the invitation to be a part of this church family. If you'd like to know more about following Jesus and what it means to take that journey with this particular group of believers, come and see me or talk with one of our members at the welcome table after the service. We'd love to tell you more. And now, as you are able, I invite you to stand as we sing our hymn of response.
Thank you.
Let us now go to the Lord in prayer, praying for our world, our nations, and our neighborhoods. Let us pray. Jesus, be with us, because we wait for you to come again into our midst. Sometimes we wait patiently, sometimes not. Always we are aware of how much the world needs you. We pray today for those in our community who need your healing and comfort. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. We pray for persons and leadership across our country, that together we might make wise decisions. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. We pray for brothers and sisters around the world, all people whose lives are torn apart by war. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. We pray knowing that you are with us now, and that you will strengthen us to keep awake, to keep the faith, to keep working for the time when Christ will come again, to surprise us anew with love and justice on earth. Help each of us to make earth a little bit more like heaven each and every day. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, we especially lift up those families in South Korea, of the people who were killed and the crowd surge last night. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, we lift up the Pelosi family. No matter what we think of their politics, their violence has no place in our politics and in our world. And so we pray for healing for Paul, and for all those who are affected by violence each and every day. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, we now pray for those to whom we are the closest, whose burdens we bear the most obviously, for members of our own families and of the family of this congregation who are sick, who are grieving, who may be struggling, especially for those we now name by typing our prayers in the live stream chat or by naming them aloud during this time of silence. The Addo family. Norman. Debbie. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. We pray this in the name of the one who loves us more than we can even ask or imagine, Jesus Christ, our Lord who is with us, who bids us to join in our church's family prayer by praying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, I forgot to mention, if you didn't see the email that went out, that we hold the Addo family in prayer, that Grace Addo, saint of the church, went to be with our Lord and Savior Thursday. And a service is being planned, and we will let you know when that is. It's looking like it might be Friday the 18th of November, but wanted you to be aware of that. And please continue to hold that entire family up in prayer for reminders of God's promise and comfort. We've now come to our service of giving, where again we are reminded that everything we have, everything is a good gift from God. And we are called to be stewards, caretakers of that. And so we return a portion joyfully back to the Lord by giving to this church to support the ministries and outreach that we do as a family. I remind you that there are three main ways to give. You can always put your offering in the boxes provided by the wall here during the special music or as you enter or leave the worship space. You can always mail a gift to the church using the postal mail. And you can go to our website, www.fupcdc.org, and you can click that online giving giving electronically. You can even set that up to be a reoccurring gift as our family does. Friends, in gratitude for all that God has done for us, let us present our tithes and offerings to the Lord.
We can stand at the edge and watch while you seek to bring hope, healing, peace, and joy to everyone in the world. Or we can take the step of committing our lives as well as our gifts in working with you in this ministry of grace. Bless our gifts, bless our lives, and bless our service. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Spirit, this is called to be ministry.
and see Christ in others. When we pray for Jesus to be with us, he is in our own hearts and in the lives we encounter as we go about our day. And then I call us, you and all of us, to be a Matthew 25 church, to go and feed the hungry, give a drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, care for the sick, visit the prisoner, and make a difference in making earth a little bit more like heaven each and every day. And as you go, may the love of God, the grace of His Son, Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.